somewhere else, King Henry is now smitten with his very own wife's lady-in-waiting, Anne Boleyn. Talented in music, the king sings to Anne in his efforts to woo her. She, however, cleverly plays hard to get, making the king fall more in love with her.
My lord.
My love.
My lord, as much as I love being with you, my lord, I can only be your wife and never your mistress. Seeing your position right now, we can never happen.
Alas, my love, you do me wrong to cast me off this courteous home.
Very well, my love. I will do whatever it takes to make you mine.
And that, my dear folks, was the start of the end of Thomas More's glory days. The end began when Thomas More refused to sign a letter by English churchmen and aristocrats, asking the Pope to end King Henry's marriage to Queen Catherine. The king wanted to divorce the queen as she could not bear him a son. In fact, the king was infatuated with Anne Boleyn. He wanted to marry her, but this could only happen outside the church, so the king sought to declare himself the supreme head of the church in England. In 1531 came the royal proclamation ordering the clergymen to acknowledge King Henry as the supreme head of the church in England as far as the law of God will permit. Thomas More at once handed in his resignation, but King Henry refused to accept it then. In May 1532, More once again handed in his resignation, claiming that he was ill and suffering from chest pains. Henry granted his request. More was chancellor for less than 3 years. This meant the loss of all his income, except for the £100 a year and the rent of some property he had purchased. Now he has to face his household members, which not only includes his immediate family members, but also the servants and young people whose education he was overseeing with this piece of bad news.
I really don't understand why you have to do what you did. Couldn't you have done what the rest did? Now we have lost everything. If we have to lose everything, at least let us know and understand the reason.
I will tell you nothing. So when they ask you what I have said, what can you tell them?
Nothing.
That's right. My silence is what will protect us. And as for all our wealth, we don't really need all these material things to lead a happy life.
I am still a happy man. I enjoy a happy life. Though my money's gone, but my blessing's not. I am still a happy man. For happy the man who learns how to pray. Happy the man whose service needs no pay. Happy the man who has a burning goal. This man has found his own soul.
He seeks no gold, he wants no gain. He knows those things are all in vain. He needs no praise, no honor to. This only mortal to yourself be true. Happy the man who learns how to pray. Happy the man whose service needs no pay. Happy the man who has a burning goal. This man has found his own soul. He seeks no gold, he wants no gain. He knows those things are all in vain. It's only mortal to yourself be true.
Be yourself be true.
Happy the man who learns how to pray. Happy the man whose service need no pay. Happy the man who has a burning goal. This man has found his own soul.
A cheerful heart, Moore at once reduced his style of living to match his strained means. And so Thomas Moore kept his silence on the new law granting King Henry the title of Supreme Head of the Church. This kept him and his family safe. But it did not last. His year-long quiet retirement at home was short-lived when he refused to attend the coronation of the new Queen Anne Boleyn, King Henry's new wife.
How dare Thomas More insult me? No. Insult us. Do something about it, or you shall have no heir to your kingdom.
Very well, my love.
Soon afterwards, Moore was falsely charged with accepting bribes. The case, however, was dismissed due to lack of evidence. Moore was then placed under the custody of the Abbot of Westminster Abbey for his repeated refusal to take the oath of supremacy, an oath which denies the authority of the Pope and gives power to the government to decide on religious matters. A few days later, Moore was imprisoned in the Tower of London and remained there for 15 months. Although he was suffering greatly in prison, Moore still joked with his family and friends on the rare occasions they were permitted to visit. The secret of Moore's great strength and power came from the Eucharist and prayer. The Eucharist was a central theme in Moore's interior life. Daily Mass was a norm for him. During his imprisonment, Moore composed many beautiful reflections on the Lord's real presence to prepare himself for Holy Communion.
Lord, I know that my faith has fallen short of what it should be. But as the father of the blind boy in the Gospel of Mark, I pray. I believe, Lord, but help my unbelief.
Receive the call of life upon.
Thomas More's favorite child and beloved daughter, Meg. Having experienced great sorrow and distress on the fate of her father, wrote him letters, begging him to change his mind and take oath.
You just
just do what you have to do.
Dearest Mac, how could you say this? How could you not truly understand me? It really grieves me to hear these words from you. Please never ask me again, my dearest Mac.
Unfortunately, it was soon discovered that Thomas More and the Bishop of Rochester, John Fisher, had been exchanging letters while in prison. This resulted in Thomas More's books and writing material being taken away.
No, no, those are Mac's letters! Those are Mac's, please!
Thomas More continued to write to his wife and beloved daughter Meg on whatever scraps of paper and pieces of charcoal he could find. As spring arrived, Thomas More knew his time was nearly up on this earth when the Carthusian monks he once lived with were executed. In fact, a few weeks later, his friend, the Bishop of Rochester, John Fisher, was executed on Tower Hill. they all died from the same stand that he, Thomas More, took. On 1st July 1535, More was tried for high treason at Westminster Hall in front of a special panel of 20 judges that included the new Lord Chancellor. Among the judges were, in fact, Queen Boleyn's father and brother and uncle. Although Thomas More believed he could not be convicted as long as he did not openly deny that the king was the head of the church, Thomas Cromwell was at the time the most powerful of the king's advisors, had a trick up his sleeve.
Silence! Silence! Order in the court! Silence! Order in the court!
We now call our witness, Solicitor General Richard Rich, to the stand.
Silence! 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 Order in the court!
I solemnly swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So help me God.
Sir Richard, can you please tell this court what was your conversation with Sir Thomas More all about?
Absolutely. When I saw him in June, Thomas More had deliberately denied that King Henry is the legitimate head of the church.
This was, of course, perjury. Despite this blatant lie, the jury found Thomas More guilty of high treason.
Any last words before your sentencing?
Since my fate is sealed before me, I shall state freely of my belief. No lay ruler could ever have jurisdiction over the Church of Christ.
Order, 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 order.
Thomas More was sentenced to be hanged, drawn, and quartered. The usual punishment for traitors. A few days later, King Henry changed his mind and sentenced Thomas More to be beheaded at Tower Hill.
Father? Father!
No, please! Give me some time with my daughter. Margaret, have patience. Do not torment yourself. It is the will of God. Pray to God for my soul.